What we've got here is failure to communicate. Some men you just can't reach. So you get what we had here last week, which is the way he wants it. Well, he gets.
And here we are.
Boom. Boom and boom.
Once again.
Yes.
Once. Episode okay. 148.
I like your shirt, Get Fit or Die.
Get Fit or Die. That yeah. is a Tim Kennedy sheepdog response.
It's even more appropriate in this day and age of COVID and all that shit.
Don't start us out.
The fitter you are, the better.
I'm going to make a, I don't know, statement. I can't think of the correct word. I will not go down the political.
Okay.
And or coronavirus rabbit hole today.
Good.
Completely
all right.
Completely not
you.
Talk about it.
All right.
We were only 40 seconds in. You said the word already. I'm not going to get derailed. Yep.
Yes.
I will not let you derail me. If you want to talk about that, those things,
I
can't stop you.
I like to just make comments.
That's good.
Yeah.
Perfectly fine. But yeah. I came in today with a plan to not discuss any of that nonsense.
It's good, man. We got plenty of other things to discuss.
You would think.
Yeah. Well, I had a list. I had to pull out the list and write down some things because I got some stuff to discuss.
Wow.
So, but before we do, we've got a Pokemon update.
Yep.
Z here, you'll appreciate this. He got, sorry, it's coronavirus related. He got sent home because someone in his class tested positive. Oh. So he had to quarantine get sent home for 14 days, which is crazy because they send the letter home. And in the letter, it even says, like, no one else in the house needs a quarantine. Just the kid needs to come home and stay home. Anyways. I know. I'm sorry. Dude, that was mean for me to fucking throw that out there.
Do they not understand how quarantines work? Anyways.
Nope. So, so he had to do the homeschool or, you know, distance learning thing. And I was like, man, I don't want this to be a pain in the ass. So, I bribed the shit out of him. And so he got a pack of Pokemon cards every day that he did his work. We sat down, we're like, you need to do this much work every day to get it done by the end of the time. And so this is what you got to do every day.
If I got all my Pokemon card packs a couple days after, I could get like a big Pokemon card pack or something.
Yeah, I told him. And if you do it all at the end, we'll get you a big treat. So it worked great. So he did all of his work. And we got through it with minimal headaches and problems. And but the net result is that he's got a shit ton of new Pokemon cards. So
that's good.
Yeah.
Well, and you should be glad, Z, because when your dad told me this happened last week, you know what I suggested that he did? That he stuck you in your room and put Saran wrap over the door and didn't let you out for 2 weeks. So if I was running the show, I would have trapped you in your room for 2 weeks, buddy.
Really?
Yep. What do you think about that? You think you'd have been all right?
Some food underneath.
We would have slid food underneath the bubble wrap that was covering your door, and you would have been stuck in there for 2 weeks. No showers, nothing.
Oh, man.
Right when you said no showers, I was like, yes!
You would have been stuck in there for 2 weeks.
Without any showers, which would be like I was in heaven.
You think you would have made it?
Yeah.
I don't know. That would have been a tough one. Your dad suggested that might not be a good idea.
Luckily, we hit upon another
solution to that problem.
So, man. No, it was good.
And I got a new big Pokemon card pack with my new most prized card.
Sweet.
All right, man.
Let's hear about it.
Yeah, let's hear the Pokemon update.
So, yeah. Which one is the most prized card? I got two I'm looking at here. That one?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Tell us about him.
It's an Eternatus V. He's
Eternatus. Okay, all right. Sorry, he looks it up. He's got a book. I stand corrected by the book of Pokemon. So
I'm just looking for it for a second.
It's all right, man. I trust you.
Yeah. Plus, that just has a Pokemon V rule, and this has like facts about it and stuff.
You got a reference book. That's all right.
That's all right, man. Let's keep the Pokemon update rolling. Z.
Okay.
All right, man.
I just can't find it.
That's all right.
It's not fun without facts.
Well, you can Give us what the Pokemon card has to say.
It has 220 hit points, and it's a darkness type. Its attacks are Power Accelerator, which does 30 damage, and Dynamax Cannon, which does 120 plus damage. Its weakness is Fighting types, which does 20 plus damage. Its resistance, it doesn't have any resistance.
Cool.
So, why is this your most prized card?
Because it's really cool and Vs are, like, really rare. And it's a V.
And you got two Vs. This one's a V card also, mm-hmm. too, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got a couple of them. And you got his cousin into him. His cousin Carter came over. And while they were in the room, he pulled out a bunch of his cards. And he's got a bunch of extras. So, he gave him a bunch of the extra cards.
Nice.
And Carter's all into him now. And so, he's wanting to start collecting them, and they got their own way of playing. Like, there's a way to play Pokemon, which is, I'm sure it's not as complicated as it looks once you learn it, but it looks fucking ridiculously complicated. And so they just have their own version that they play, which works.
Which works, yeah.
So, all right, man, anything else?
Not really, but I did bring another card in here to share.
All right, well, we'll share them next time, dude.
Okay.
Okay, so.
Are you ready for Christmas?
Yeah.
When this episode will come out on Christmas Day.
Oh, man, Merry Christmas.
So, yep. A week from yesterday, yeah. Correct?
Yeah. Yep. So.
Yeah, I just can't find it.
All right, buddy. If you want to go look through the book, you need to go. We're done with the Pokemon update, and so.
What if I find it out there?
No.
I found it.
I found it. Listen, man.
There are facts about it.
Alright, quick. And okay. Then
Pokemon Sword. The core on its head, on its chest, absorbs energy. Okay, yeah. It's hard to read.
Alright, well.
Thanks, dude.
Appreciate the effort. Maybe that's for practicing and having it down. Comes in.
Bye.
All right, dude. See ya.
Merry Christmas to everyone that's listening.
See ya, buddy.
Bye.
Later, dude.
You and Rob are too close, but bye.
All right.
Not quite sure.
I'm not sure what he meant either. So.
Either. So, it's all right. Yeah. Dude, he gets dragged down. He's just so funny, man. He has no awareness of, like, other people aren't as interested in some things as he is. And so, like, this morning, like, Kiele had to stop because he's sitting there with every card. He's like, hey, Mom, this. Hey, Mom, that. And I'm like, I told him before. It's like, man, it's not that people don't want to listen. It's just they're doing stuff. People are doing stuff. And so you're, you know, interrupting them all the time because you find something interesting. It's just hard as a kid. Don't. Yeah. You just. And so that's why it's, you know, I just laugh and shake my head.
I remember you had to give him that talk because he's been in this Pokemon kick for, I don't know how long now. But I remember, because every time I'd come over, he would, you know, bombard me with all the Pokemon.
Yeah.
And I remember you like, hey, listen, Z. Everyone's not as pumped on Pokemon as you are.
Yeah.
Let's dial it back a notch.
Yeah. It's interesting.
It's funny.
Trying to get, what is it? Yeah. Empathy, the ability to kind of see things from other people's point of view. It's a skill you have to develop. We're not born with it. So, but it's fucking hilarious because his cousin, again, they were hanging out and his cousin's talking about, like, you know, trying to control his temper and not get mad at stuff. And apparently Z's sitting there telling him, like, well, you can just take a deep breath. And, like, we'll think of something else. And, you know, all the stuff that I tell him that he doesn't do. Mm-hmm. But he's, like, telling his cousin to do it. And then his cousin's like, you know, well, that doesn't work for me. I hyperventilate. Or, you know, trying to argue with him. And he's, like,
oh, God.
Trying
to and talk. These are 7-year-olds, right?
Yeah, yeah.
7 and 8-year-olds having this conversation.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. It's funny. So, he's listening. It's just acting on it that is the hard part. So... But, so anyways, here we are, ready to talk some some interesting stuff. So we'll start with the jiu-jitsu news. Kiyoli's brother's doing jiu-jitsu now.
Nice.
Yeah.
This is the karate guy?
Yes. Yes. Our buddy Brian over on Kauai, he's got, I forget exactly, I think, because they got, Hawaii is maybe a little worse, if not like on par with like California as far as like lockdowns and just,
That's what I was going to ask. Yeah. Like, how is he getting involved in it now? Because I'm going to speculate.
Well, cause same reason, it's the same, if you're doing jiu-jitsu, like, most places that are doing jiu-jitsu are fucking ignoring this, because you can't do jiu-jitsu with social distancing. Like, I know they say you can see pictures of places trying, but it looks silly. It's not really jiu-jitsu. And so, but that was what got him wanting to do it, is because his karate place that he's doing karate, either, I forget what it was, like, they were going to make him wear masks, or there was something related that he was like, man, this is horseshit. And so he's like, oh, well, the jiu-jitsu place is still just going, so I'll go do that. And I don't have to wear a mask and all this crazy stuff. So that's what got him into doing jiu-jitsu, is it's a more convenient martial art at the moment instead of having to try to do karate in a mask, which would, God, I can't even imagine. I mean, I guess you adapt to it. Ninjas did it.
Yeah, they wore masks all the time.
Yeah, at least according to the movies, which...
That's 100% accurate.
Historically accurate, sure.
Exactly, for sure.
So, but yeah, we got him a gi for Christmas, and so...
Sweet.
Yeah. He's done a few classes. The first class is always the interesting one, right? It's like, if you can make it past the first class, then, you know, odds are pretty good you're going to make it for a few months, right? And then... I mean, it's interesting how there's these points where, like, if you make it past this, then
you should make it to this
next. Probably gonna get to this next stage.
This next milestone.
Yeah, whatever, this next milestone might be where, you know, if you can get past that, and so, but yeah, he made it past the first class, and he was, I guess he told Kelly he had to tap out to a triangle, and he's like, yeah, I was about to pass out, so I had to tap out, and she was just like, well, you probably want to tap out before that, and oh yeah, and. His source of information in the jiu-jitsu world is the Grumpy Guy Podcast.
Which, at one point in time, we used to talk about a lot of jiu-jitsu.
Yeah, the original episodes were all...
jiu-jitsu focused, yes. For the most part. We'd get derailed here and there, but it was heavy on the Brazilian jiu-jitsu topic.
Yeah, so I mean...
It hasn't been so much lately.
Advice for white belts and stuff. But that was the point, is, you know, we say it once and then there it is. So you can go back and... see what our advice to white belts are. And so, but yeah, he's been listening to Grumpy Guy Podcast and watching some of the videos I had on the Fruit of BJJ website. And then, yeah, that's how he prepared for his first class.
Is he liking it? Have you heard since the
first
few classes?
I mean, it seems like he's enjoying it. So, I mean, the feedback from Kiele seems to be more positive. I mean, he's not like... oh, this is bullshit, or, you know, not quite sure, or whatever. Seems like he's getting into it, so.
I look forward to the day where I hear the story that he has completely abandoned karate and taken on jiu-jitsu 100% as his martial arts to practice. His
primary martial art. That would be interesting, because I wrestling is what makes jiu-jitsu so much fun.
Right.
And that's why we do it all. Man, it's so that we can slap hands and fucking wrestle with someone.
Get after each other. Right?
Yeah, like that's the pinnacle of it.
Yeah.
And there's nothing else like that in any other martial art, which is, again, what makes jiu-jitsu so unique. And so I don't know. I think, like, once you experience that, especially if you're a martial artist, how do you not?
Like, it's so fun.
Yeah, how do you not want more of this?
Yep.
Like, more and more. It's, that white belt phase is, that's the best one, man. Every time you come in, you're getting better.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't seem like it at the moment, but...
Once you tap somebody for the first time, like, legitimately, they, you know, they're not letting you get something or this and that, and then you're like, oh. You know, as you have that little milestone keeps you going, and then once you've been at it for a month or two, and then some new guy comes in, And yeah. And you can just kind of toy with a new guy that doesn't know anything, and you're like, oh my God.
Then yeah.
I can completely do whatever I want to this guy. He has zero idea what's happening right now.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, it's.
Once a few of those things happen, man, it's hard to deny.
I think so.
Whatever rationale or preconceived ideas you have, once a couple of those things like that happen, it's got to be similar to like meth or heroin, you know what I mean? Once you get addicted, you're like, oh,
yeah,
this is great. No wonder why people like this.
Yeah.
This is amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. I know, which is why I don't understand why people quit. I mean, don't want to do it. But, I mean, you know, man, getting adults to do jiu-jitsu is tough.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's really tough.
Dude, I mean, it's tough. Like, dude, I've been doing jiu-jitsu since, what, 2000? I always lose the date, but like, let's just say 2004, you know, so 16, going on 17 years. And there's days, you know, like, man, like yesterday was a good example, dude. It was a challenging week at work, all the snow, just a ton of hours. And dude, I was in such a, just like a sleep deprivation, shitty mood yesterday. Just like, fuck, like Thursday, I'd kind of hit my breaking point. And then Thursday night, dude, I didn't leave work. I was a little over 14-hour day by the time I left work and got, you know, I mean, 14 hours on the clock. So, you know, I've been gone from home, you know, 15 hours, you know, give or take. And I was just fried. I woke up and had to do it again yesterday. And I got out early yesterday. I think my boss could kind of sense because I was pretty short fused. I was at my, like, I get to that point and I don't take shit from anybody and my filter's gone. Like, I'll just fucking, like, if something's bothering me, guess what? You're going to hear it, you know, and I don't give a fuck what position you're in at the company. Like, hey, this is stupid. We're not doing it like this. But, you know, like, yeah. And I think when they see my filter go out the window, my boss is like, all right, we should probably send him. So I got out a little early yesterday and I went home and took a nap and then I woke up and I knew I should go train. And there was a voices in my head telling me like, don't go train. And I pulled it together. I went and trained. I was really, obviously, I knew I'd be really glad once I got there.
Yeah.
Once I got there and got on the mat, just slapped hands and I was like, okay. And then once I left, it just changed my mindset. Like, it was such a better place. I'm still pretty short fused today. I can sense it.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have any tolerance for stupid motherfuckers right now. I normally don't. But when I get to this stage, like, dude, there's zero tolerance. But it's tough, man. No matter how much I love it, and even I know how good I'll feel afterwards. I'll have those mental battles.
Yeah.
And they're like, nah, you don't need to. You start rationalizing. Like, you don't need to go train. You should do this. You should do that. And, you just got to overcome those things.
Yeah, that's the thing. I don't think that people realize that everybody struggles with this shit. Like, you know, you're not fired up every time you go in to train jiu-jitsu. Mm-hmm. Like, you're glad you did, but it's like, you see, like, there's days where you're not as, you know, mentally into it. But, like, those are the days that if you overcome those, like, that's what makes you better. And just knowing that on some level helps drive you to do that. Mm-hmm. But, like, and that's the trick. It's like motivation is fleeting. And it's like, man, you got to have your habits in place. You got to have these kind of higher level things that you're aspiring to and that you judge yourself by, you know, because if you don't, like, then you're just gonna always take the easiest way, you know, easiest common denominator, and then you're never gonna finish anything. I mean, no matter what it is, when you start, there's a certain motivation level that always goes away.
Mm-hmm.
Always, with everything. There's nothing out there. And if you don't learn how to, like, overcome that and, you know, get your ass to the gym on those days, like, you're never going to accomplish anything anywhere. And again, that's what's, like, so fucking awesome about jiu-jitsu is it allows you this opportunity to strengthen, like, your will and your character in a way that, you know, you usually don't get. It transfers over and everything else is better and all that stuff. But, yeah, man, it's always tough. And I mean, there's definitely days where I'm like, man, I don't want to fucking go in and train.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm sore, I'm tired. Like, but yeah, like you said, like, you go in and you know you're going to feel better And when you do, and you're going to, it's, and very rarely, I can't even, I'm sure there's been a time or two, I can't remember them, but I don't ever remember leaving a training session feeling bad and being like, oh, I shouldn't have done that.
No. I mean, like you say, like, I'm sure there's been a time or two that's happened in the past 16, 17 years, but I can't remember.
Yeah.
Very, very, very few times.
Yeah. And it probably had to do with more like I had trained so much that that was a mistake going in and training that day because I'm breaking myself. Yep. And
that, or, you know, some training partner flakes out on you. You know, you show up and.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're like, God damn it. Like, why? Like, I had a feeling he was going to flake out. Why the fuck did I show? You know what I mean? Yep. But besides that, yeah, man. There's...
Yeah. So, anyways, that's the fucking.
So I hope he sticks with it.
Some advice for you there. Yeah, it's gonna. There's some up and downs with everything. So, man, it's funny that competition, that shooting intro to competition shooting, I think is what that class was I took. And, dude, there's so many similarities between pistol craft and jiu-jitsu.
Yep.
It's insane. Like, you can just, you could literally just substitute the words for each other and like give some advice on how to get better at it, and just like I said, swap the words and it'll apply to either one.
Have you I agree 100%. Have you noticed in this handgun rabbit hole we've both been down that I believe all the coaching and information out there in the handgun competition handgun world, or even, you know, handguns in general, is like a little behind where jiu-jitsu is. You know, as far as how they disseminate information and how they coach people, and the thought processes behind things, it's just a couple steps behind.
Yeah,
you know, jiu-jitsu's catching up pretty good. You know, with all the coaching techniques and, you know, and things like that. It's funny, the handgun world, the pistol world is a little behind that.
Yeah,
it's funny because you get the same arguments. People, you have the whole. Competition shooting isn't good for self-defense.
Right.
Just like sport jiu-jitsu. And it's the exact same arguments, dude. And it's the exact same rebuttals. It's funny, man, when I hear these podcasts. I'm just like, oh, shit. Like, these people are just a few years behind.
I mean, you know what the funny thing is, though, man? I wouldn't even say, like, that conversation's still going on in jiu-jitsu. You still hear it.
Yeah.
It's not like it's been settled.
No, but...
You still have your hardcore self-defense guys that sport jiu-jitsu will get you killed on the streets. Like, it's still, you know, there. But again, like, what's funny is the... Because you are 100% right in that, like, you are hearing the exact same arguments, the exact same rebuttals.
Yep,
and
exact.
And there's holes in... The exact same holes in both, which is like, well, you shouldn't be doing either one exclusively. You know, like the hardcore self-defense guy, whether it's, you know, pistol craft or fucking jiu-jitsu, his argument is that, well, you know, competition is an unrealistic environment and it's a game. And so people are going to try to figure out how to win the game. Mm-hmm. And so they're going to do things that may not necessarily work in real life because they work in the environment of this game. And then when you get confronted with a real life situation, you're going to default back to what you trained for this game and it's not going to work and it's going to get you... You know, fucking hurt, right? I mean, again, you can insert guns or jiu-jitsu.
Whatever, yeah.
It's the same argument. And then, but again, the answer is, well, you shouldn't just be doing competition. Like, I mean, unless that's all you want to do. And again, there's people out there that have zero desire to do jiu-jitsu for self-defense.
Mm-hmm.
None. It's just, they want to do sport jiu-jitsu. The competition is what they really love, just going down the fucking crazy rabbit holes of, you know, worm guard and all the you know, stuff that you know, wouldn't work on the street, quote unquote, whatever. And that's fine, right? But I think that most people who are into jiu-jitsu have some element of self-defense. Like, I want to be doing this for self-defense on some level. I would hope that if I needed it, I could use it in a way to help me. I mean, it'd just be silly to be like, that dude got his ass kicked. You know, he's a fucking gold medalist at all these competitions. Like, I think most people agree that'd be stupid. But, you know, the fucking, oh, dude, what the hell? What was my point? I totally lost my point. I started thinking about something else for a second. But, oh, no, you just don't want to do either one, right? It's right. Like, if all you're doing is the competition and you're not learning any basic self-defense stuff from jiu-jitsu, like, you're going to have holes in your game. You're not going to be a complete martial artist. And same thing with shooting, man. It's like, but you can't say that there's not some benefit.
Like, the benefits outweigh the negatives. Because most people, whether it's jiu-jitsu or... I'm maybe speaking a little out of turn when it comes to handguns because we're so new to it, but when it comes to jiu-jitsu, most people realize that if they're heavy on the competition side, they're not ignorant enough to think that, you know, they are the, you know, baddest motherfucker when it comes to, you know, self-defense or actual fights. You know, like in this day and age, I think most people realize that.
Yeah.
You know, and MMA has shown that time and time again. You take some guy that's some world champion guy at jiu-jitsu and throw him in the cage, if he didn't get his striking up to par, you know, he's going to get his ass whooped. You know, and he didn't work on his wrestling, he didn't work on his striking. It's not, I mean, he might do okay, but chances are he's going to get fucked up. And, you know, and I think most people understand that. You know, I don't think, there's not a lot of really dumb people out there that, you know, think heavy one way or the other. At least in my opinion.
Yeah.
And it's, I mean, again, there's outliers.
Yeah, and, but, yeah.
But, yeah, it's funny. It's a funny crossover.
Yeah.
It really is. It cracks me up, man. I get listening to these podcasts and reading articles, and it's just, you literally could just change the title of it and just, you know, is competition, you know, jiu-jitsu good for self-defense? Or is competition shooting good for self-defense?
Yeah.
And just go through the article, swap out the words, and it would make perfect sense.
Yes,
the
yeah,
same
no.
arguments, yeah, fucking yeah. everything. Dude, it's so funny, man.
It is funny, man. Yeah. And, but yeah, I found that interesting. I've been reading a couple books that I found on it, and it's really, one of them was just kind of a collection of articles. I think the guy's name's Ron Avery.
That name sounds familiar.
Yeah.
I think he was a Colorado guy.
Yeah, yeah, no, he's a Colorado guy, yeah. What is it called, like Precision Shooting or something like that was the name of it. It was actually the guy that, the guy Riley Bowman mm-hmm. on Concealed Carry, he talked about a few episodes that he was reading it. And so, but anyways, he's an ex-law enforcement officer, and it's a collection of articles and stuff that he did for a website. But yeah, man, having the same exact discussion in that book about, like, yeah, you know, competition, if used properly, is going to make you better. Like, there's no denying it. There's no arguing with that. But you need to be rounding it out with other things in order to, you know, be a well-rounded you know, martialist, really. I mean, that's really what it is, man, is, like, it is a martial skill. Like, that is the weapon of our day. It's mm-hmm. like a long sword in, you know, fucking samurai days in Japan. It was like, that was the pinnacle, the top weapon. And if you didn't know how to use it or defend yourself against it, you were at a distinct disadvantage against people who knew how to use it. And so that's like, that's what the gun is today, is like, that is the martial weapon of the time. And so it all ties itself together with, you know, being a martial artist. And so, but again, you see that, like, cause they talk about that a lot in these articles and in the books that I'm reading, is like, you have to develop more than just your shooting skills. Like, if you don't know how to grapple, if you don't know how to handle yourself in a hand-to-hand situation, like, you're going to put yourself and other people in danger because someone's going to fucking take you to the ground and take your weapon from you, and now all of a sudden the situation's worse than it was. Mm-hmm. And so, like, if even competition or not, like, if all you're focused on is shooting, and your goal, you know, as a law enforcement officer or just as like a, you know, a civilian defender or, you know, whatever the fuck you want to call us. Like you, if that's all you're focused on, you're still not well-rounded. So
no, it can't be the only tool in your toolbox because you need to have other options.
Yeah.
Because, you know, using that weapon to defend yourself or your family or loved ones, man, needs to be absolute last resort. And if you don't have good self-defense skills, that's going to be your first choice. And that's not good.
No.
You know, you need to assess the situation. Okay, can I just leave? Did I have good situational awareness and I just got out of here? That should be my first
thing.
You know, okay, I can't quite get out of here. Okay, can I just go hands-on with this guy and, you know, fix the situation? You know, hopefully that'll solve it. And then you have to run through the tools that you have at your disposal. And if you don't have those fucking tools, man, just carrying around a weapon, it's not a good idea.
Yeah.
It's going to get you in more trouble.
Yeah.
It really is.
Dude, you hear about those. I love like the Justified Saves episodes of the Concealed Carry podcast are great, man, because, you know, they cover, you know, they call them Justified Saves, but they cover things that were like, here's what you don't want to do. You know, here's what you definitely want to do. And, man, you hear, I mean, there's people that have guns still get fucking shot and killed.
Yep.
Like, just because you have a gun doesn't mean that you're automatically going to win every encounter that you have. And that's why you got to do everything you fucking can to put every advantage on your side that you can. Like, you know, is the reason that you had to engage with this target in the first place is because you couldn't fucking run. Are you too fucking fat and out of shape to just run? And so now, like, you're forced to engage with an assailant that you shouldn't have to. But you can't run and jump and climb that fence and get the fuck out of here. And so now you got to deal with this knife-wielding maniac.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then it's like, yeah, that's, like, that is... You want to put every... We were talking about this with, like, the holsters, right? Like, you know, you want to put every... Stack everything in your favor that you can in a fight. Like, it's not about fair. So, like, just... If you get a holster that gives you just a little bit better grip and advantage of drawing it, it's like, dude, I want that. You want every advantage that you can get in those... in that. And that's where having, you know, being fit, having the wrestling skills, like, that's what I've really liked, man, is seeing that stuff is talked about. And, you know, I don't know how, like, it seems, I don't want to use the word emphasize because, you know, I don't know how much it is emphasized because I am new to this stuff, but you see it, man. You see people talking about strength and conditioning. You see people talking about, you know, your ability to defend yourself in a, you know, hand-to-hand situation. So it's like, I don't know, it's cool. Like, I like it because it's a well-rounded thing. It's like, you know, even jiu-jitsu, man, I love jiu-jitsu, but it is a bit myopic.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, honestly, the only situation that jiu-jitsu is helping you with is a one-on-one unarmed situation.
Mm-hmm.
Really? Which is great. But there's crossover, like jiu-jitsu plus a gun, jiu-jitsu plus a knife. That's way more effective than just a gun or just a knife, right? So, like, jiu-jitsu is this platform that you can build all these other fucking combat and martial skills off of. But just jiu-jitsu itself, like I said, there's really very limited... If you think about all the types of situations that you might find yourself in, man, jiu-jitsu only addresses a pretty small percentage of those situations.
But it is the excellent foundation.
Exactly.
To build on.
Exactly.
To help with those other situations.
Right, yeah.
It is a great, it in my opinion, is the best foundation.
Yeah, I agree. I agree 100%.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like there's, yeah, 100%. But I guess like what I'm saying though is that that's why I like getting into this, because you see them talking about like, oh, you need these other things. Like, it's not just about being able to shoot someone. Like, you know, you need to be able to deal with all these situations. And it's like, yeah, I don't know, just that martialist attitude of like, you know, we have to look objectively at what might be asked of us and then fill those holes.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of just living in a dream world that a gun's going to get me out of everything or jiu-jitsu's going to get me out of everything. It's like, no, man, like synergy, like that's between all these things is what's going to get you out. And I don't know, I like that. It's fucking, it's cool and an exciting thing to get into. So, yeah, I don't know. Any other?
Yeah, no, I agree 100%. I don't know what else I could add to it.
No?
But speaking of competition, you went and did that competition, intro to competition shooting class?
Yes.
Let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, man. So, besides the 4 inches of snow that fell on us during the class, which was an interesting experience, but you know, again, this is a good example. Like, I'm not doing competition to get better at competition. I'm interested in competition to get better at my pistol craft, and that I may have to use that in the snow.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, bitching out on that class because it wasn't like good conditions. Like, no, that's not in the spirit of what I'm doing this for. Right. And so like, I looked at it as an interesting challenge. I didn't realize how much snow we were going to have, or else I would have brought my snow boots. Cause by the end of the day, my fucking feet were so cold, man. They're soaked. And yeah. So we were in those bays, something like where we worked with Al.
Okay.
And so they had the first bay set up for the first competition rule set. So we go out and they show us, okay, here's the basics. And like I was saying, man, they are super strict on guns here, ammo here. The two do not meet until you are
in this box.
In the field of competition and have been told by the judge, or you know, the guy running it, to load. And so it's very strict, but you've got the table. Remember that safety table, that wooden table that's off to the side?
Yep.
So no ammunition there. You can't even take snap caps or like shell, you know, casings, nothing. Nothing to do with ammunition. Not even magazines, nothing. Just your gun. So that's where you would go and holster up. So like you would get your holster on. You've got your gun in a bag. So either your range bag, or this is where like they have their own like pistol, like bags for the pistol or whatever. Cause then they can just take that over to the safety table, open it up, and that's where you can handle the gun. And so you take the gun out and you holster it. That's also like, if you wanted to go do like some dry fire practice, just getting some sight stuff, you can go over to that table at any point. And like, that's where you handle your gun.
Okay.
It's the only place you can touch your gun. And so once you've holstered up, then you can go back to the main, pavilion, the shed thing. Mm-hmm. And then that's where you can touch your ammunition. And so that's where you get your ammo loaded and magazines ready and all that stuff there. Can't touch your gun in there at all. And then, so yeah, that was like the first thing. Like, okay, this is how we do this. And of course, I'm like touching the gun in the shed. And they're like, see, this is what we're talking about. You don't want to do that. And I'm like, because they told us to holster up. And my gun was in my holster. And so I was going to go pull my gun out of the holster to put my holster on.
Okay.
But see, that's not...
That's a no-no?
That's a no-no. Like, because I'm touching the gun...
In the ammo shed, basically.
Yep, in the ammo shed.
Your hand does not even get placed on your firearm.
For any reason whatsoever. If you have to touch your firearm, you have to carry whatever it is in to that safety table. There's where you can open it up and touch it. So, that's why, yeah. So, I had to take my bag over there, and then that's where I could pull my gun out, put my holster on, then holster and all that stuff. And so, but yeah, so that was, and then, so once they got over that, got us all on the safety train, then they started talking about the 180 degree rule, like you can't point your pistol past 180 degrees, basically behind you, right, in any direction, which, again, makes sense. You don't want to be shooting back towards fucking... the people who are, watching or whatever. And then we started going through the rules. And the first one was a steel challenge. They just have this box you stand in. And they got five steel targets. And you can engage them in any order you want. You just got to put one hit on it. And then it's a time thing. And so they have the last one that's got the red pole or whatever. And so when you shoot that, that's when your time stops. And so, you just go through that. And I guess they...
So, do on that one, I'm just thinking of gaming. Yeah. Said gaming the system. So, once you shoot that final target, your time stops.
Yep.
If you... I'm sure they got a rule in place, so you can't just do this. But so, you have four other targets. If you don't hit those other targets, you get a penalty. Like, it's a second penalty.
It's some sort of time penalty, yeah. It makes it not worth...
So, it wouldn't... you couldn't just shoot the end target and call it good. Like, they say go... Plink, done. So you have a 0.2 second time plus a 4 second penalty.
Yeah, no, it wouldn't.
People would do that.
No.
I'm obviously not the smartest guy.
Yeah, so, no, I'm sure there's something in place for that.
The penalty's big enough to warrant that.
Those dudes are fucking blazing those things.
So fast.
So fast. Yeah, that was the cool thing, was getting to watch them demo the stage. So they're like, they explain the rules, this is how it's going to work. Okay, we're going to do it first, and then we got to go. And so, yeah, watching those dudes go, and that's where, like, you can use a 22 on the steel challenge. And so, you know, you get those fucking 22 competition pistols. They got zero recoil.
Just real long barrel. Yeah. There's barely any recoil.
Yeah. And So anyways, but the real challenge with the steel challenge is they had freshly sprayed the target, so they're all white,
mm-hmm.
and the fucking berm was covered in snow. It was all white.
Oh, I didn't even think about that.
So having to, like, you know, it wasn't, like, super hard, but it was a bit of a challenge. Like, yep. you had to, you know, look a little bit harder to pick out targets, especially, like, the further ones. There were two that were probably, like, you know, 10 yards away, then they had two that were, like, 20, 25 yards away. And then they had the one in the middle, which in this round was the one that stopped it, which was about 15. And so, but yeah. And then I got picked to be the first one to go each time, which is fine with me. I mean, I was like, hell yeah, dude, I'll be the Huckleberry.
Mm-hmm.
I made a career out of raising my hand. So, so I was the first one to go. And yeah, you just fucking shoot them. And again, the main thing, they got all these commands. I was telling you, that's, you know, are you ready? Yes. Or, you know, make ready or load and make ready. And that's when you load your gun, you know, and then they're, set. And then they do the buzzer and that's when you go. And then when you're done.
Do you do it from the draw? Is that part of the time?
Yep.
So are your hands up in the surrender position or your hands at your side?
We just did it from the side, but it varies. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. With the other ones where they're kind of more situational specific, I mm-hmm. think that it depends on, they'll tell you where you start. But the steel challenge, I think you just start. It's like a fucking quick draw competition. It's not quite as self-defense oriented as much as just shooting but it shit.
Is, that's part of the time.
You got to draw.
Draw and then on target.
Yep, draw, boom, put sights on target and then fucking plink away. And then when you're done, when you stop shooting, they'll say, if you're done, you know, unload and clear or something along those lines. But the key thing is if you're done, because if right then you realize like, oh, I forgot to shoot something, like you can still go, like, you know, so they give you like, just because you stop shooting, then they ask if you're done, blah, blah, blah. But again, like I said, if you remember right then, like, oh, fuck, I forgot to shoot a target back here, you can go back and engage it or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're done, then you drop your magazine, pull back, show them an empty chamber, let it go, and then holster. Like I was telling you, you got to holster, like, you know, clear your, if you got a jacket on, you got to clear deliberate. The jacket. And they kept telling me, like, hand up here. Like, I don't think they'll DQ you for not having your hand up here as much as it's just a good habit. Because they're mm-hmm. like, if your hand's up here, there's no way that it can get in the way of your, so yeah, getting your free hand up in your chest and then holstering. Because if you flag any part of your body, you're DQ'd. So that's another reason they were saying it's not a good idea to point the gun down at the ground when you're moving, because there's a chance you might sweep your foot or something like that, and technically that's going to be a DQ. So, you know, they were like, man, muzzle down range is the best thing to think about. So so the steel challenge was that, and then we did like the USPCA mm-hmm. and the IDPA
or something like that.
Yeah, I can't remember, but they're basically more like defensive shooting oriented, trying to create scenarios and get human shaped targets that you're putting rounds on. And so they got a little bit different scoring system. But like I was saying, the main difference is with the first one that we did, I think the USPSA or whatever, is you're free to engage the stage as you want. So they've got targets and then you, and they're like, yeah, okay, this is the no shoot, and you know, here's the ones here. And then, like I said, you can pick any order you want and do it like you want. And then the other one, they tell you, like, you got to do this one here and this one here and this one here and follow the order. And so, and I think the second one, the IDPA or whatever, like, they do the kind of more situational specific, and it'll change. Man, they were talking about, like, they do shit from, you know, snowmobiles, from inside cars, from at a desk. So, like, they really get creative with the stages trying to create. So, like, the one that we did was, you know, you're coming out of a convenience store and you're mugged and you've got to defend yourself and then help your friend who's still inside the store being attacked. And so, you know, you got these targets around that you got to engage. But that's the scenario. And so each scenario can be different. I think the other one, they're more standardized. Like, they have the stages that are more, you know, which ones they're going to run may change, but they have like a playbook of stages. Same thing with Steel Shot. Like, there's a playbook that they're picking from. They're not just freestyling the courses like they are with the other one.
Okay.
So, yeah, but you had to put generally two hits on each target. Your A zone, one you got scored, and the other one is like a time penalty thing. But they both basically want you to put like a center mass hit, or they have like a, you know, you can hit the head too. And one of them had like, you know, part of the target was blacked out to represent like body armor or something like that. So you had to, if you hit an area that usually would be scored something, it would be considered a miss with it. And then you had no shoot targets that were like, you know, behind targets you had to engage. They had these wall things up and you can't shoot through the walls. So that's not an option. Can't go fucking John Wick and just blast the walls down. And then, yeah, man, got to run and move, and it's very dynamic. It was a lot like, you know, what we were doing with Al towards the end, where it was like, do this and this, and then go over here and do this and this. And so, it's funny, man. I feel like I do way better with that than I do just sitting there trying to shoot something. Like, dude, going out to the range and trying to shoot shit is frustrating. But, man, I got my scores up here. I'll show you the fucking score sheet that they gave us. But, you know, I'm just running through, and, man, it's interesting. It's like any other sort of competition, you know. You're when you're doing it, it's such a cool world to be in when you're competing. It's just like with jiu-jitsu, right? It's like when you're on the mat, all of a sudden it's just like,
whoosh, yep,
this is it. Like, everything else is gone. And the same thing there, man. It's like, you know, snow's falling, my feet are freezing, all this shit. But when it was time to go, it was gone. It was just me, the target, my fucking sights, and, trying to put fucking rounds on, and then, you know, evaluate, did I miss? You know, was that a good hit? Do I need to put another one on it? You know, run over to the fucking walls and shit. So, but, yeah, like the first one, this was my steel shot times. So it's hilarious. I got worse each time. I did like under 8 seconds the first one, and then just got slower from there. But then, yeah, this is the USPSA. And so, man, you see I got two A's on all the targets. The only thing I fucked up on was hitting the no-shoot target.
Grazed the no-shoot?
Yeah, I clipped him in the leg. Luckily, it wasn't a headshot. Like, if it was a real scenario, like, he would have lived, man. It was just barely.
Sometimes that's the option. Sometimes shooting the hostage is the correct solution.
Oh, that's the other thing. USPSA, if I shoot through something and it hits another target, that does not count. So, like, if I shot the no-shoot on accident, and the bullet passes through and hits the target that I was actually shooting at, that doesn't count. But the IDPA, it does. So, if I shoot through something and it strikes, then that hit counts. So, again, a little bit different.
Gotcha.
I don't think that shooting through a hostage is really the strategy that we want to employ. But, I'm fucking putting two hits on. And then, this one was the time penalty. And so I got 3 seconds. Oh, yeah, that was.
What'd you do there?
So this one was real fun. The IDPA one was probably the funner of the two. And so we had to start out, man, I'm like from here to you from the target.
Okay.
And then I had to draw two in the chest, one in the head.
Okay.
And I was the only one you had to engage three times. Everyone else was two. And then I turned around, and that was the one that had the target to the side that you could either run up and engage stationary or engage on the move.
Okay.
As you're going to the next spot. And so I decided at the last second I was going to engage it on the move, and almost like broke the 180 degree rule, because you're shooting as you're walking, and all of a sudden it's like, whoa, okay, I'm almost past 180 degrees. And then they had a wall set up, which is basically like a mesh net on a wooden frame. I mean, like, say,
like a partition. Just
Yeah. So it's not very sturdy. It was my point, because I run up to it and you had to engage a target here and then kind of come around the partition and engage a target. And then and I ran up to it, and I practiced with my throwing wall, my knife throwing wall, shooting from cover, putting my gun and using, you know, putting my muzzle right on the side and using it for some extra stability. And so I go up and I do that on that one and I fucking shoot. And dude, that is not a solid partition.
No.
They fucking moved. And it dumped snow on my gun. So, like, I couldn't see my sights for half a second. Like, it took me a half second to realize, like, what the fuck? Wait a minute. You know, and then I can't do this. And so I had to, like, you know, I just fucking put back on and shot. That may be where I got the 1 second penalty there.
That's good that happened, though. I mean, that's real life.
It is. That's why I say, man, it was fucking, it was, and then my gun, my next round was a bad round.
Okay.
Yeah. So I had to fucking clear it there. And then you engage the two, and then you had to go to the other side of the wall, and there were targets there you had to engage. And on the way is when you wanted to reload, because you had to be strategically thinking, keep a track of your hits. And the reason is on the other side of the wall, there was a steel target you had to engage. When you hit it, it dropped. It pulled a rope that engaged what they call a popper target. So at first, it's off to the side, and it's not facing you. When you hit the steel target, it pulls the rope, it pulls it, it faces you, turns away, faces you again, turns away, and that's it.
So you only have those...
Like, you have those two turns to get your two hits on it.
Oh, that's interesting.
And you got to go from, like, hitting the steel to turning and engaging this target that's fucking moving.
So if you're really good and fast, you'll get it on the first presentation to you.
Yeah.
But if you're...
Well, like, guy,
like
yeah.
a beginner like me,
yeah.
I would probably have to turn... assess and then wait for that second presentation.
Well, see, that's where I got my three, is I turned and shot on the first rotation. I turned and just put sights on it and shot.
Okay.
And then on the second rotation, I had a better sight picture. And then I was able to shoot the zero zone or whatever the fuck. But yeah, that first one is where I got the three, because I'm like trying to turn and just put a shot on it. You know,
that'd be hard to do. I mean, target acquisition.
Yeah.
Because you're going from far focus to near focus. Because you're turning, you got your far focus to get the target, then you're trying to get back to near focus on your front sight.
Yeah.
And trying to get that good engage. Picture. Yeah. I mean, yeah. There's a lot going on there.
And then when you've done that, you got to go back. And I was where, like, you, the last target, if you timed it right, and Walt did it when he ran through the course, you could shoot the steel, put your two hits on that target, and then turn and engage that target. So like, you still had, you hit the steel, and there were still two targets you had to engage. Okay. There was the one flipping, and then there was one that was like to the right of the no shoot. And so, you know, normally if you're a normal human, you go bing, boom, boom, boom. You know, Walt goes through and goes bing, boom, 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 boom.
Because he had time.
Yeah, well, he's just so fucking fast, man. Yeah, I mean, he had that, you know, he's so quick with his sight acquisition.
And that was the guy we met that,
yeah.
Basically, like the general manager of the place.
Yeah. So, yeah, he's a super nice guy, man. And
did he remember you?
Yeah, when we started talking a little bit. And yeah, so, but yeah, man, so that's what the fucking scoring is like. And they were saying that IDPA one, he was like, dude, this was one of the smallest and easiest, like, stages you'll find. Like, they
get pretty complicated.
Yeah, you're engaging a bunch of targets. That's the one where you had to put 10 plus 1 to start. Because they wanted you to have to run out of ammo and do a reload during the stage. Like, that's part of the strategy as well. Like, you know, keeping track of your rounds, you know.
That's a lot to think about.
Yeah.
That's a lot going on.
And that's what they were saying. Like, what you don't want to have happen is you hit that steel target and you turn to engage this popper and you're out. Or you've only got one shot left.
You don't have, because you're not going
to
have the time.
No, not going to have time to reload. And so, yeah. Huh. Yeah, dude. No, I know. I was
that's
like,
dude, cool. I'm gonna have to go out there and do that class. You know, just for the experience.
Yeah.
And the coaching.
Fuck yeah, man. Yeah, but like I said, especially like the steel challenge, just, you know,
pretty sure
showing up and shooting and making sure you don't flag yourself. But yeah, when you're starting to move around and, you know, you got all the different things you got to keep in mind. But yeah, it's fun, man. And they run these things every month. So
the competitions,
or yeah, yeah, they run an IDPA and a USPSA and the steel challenge every month out there. So the steel challenge they run on Sunday, so that'll be easy to make.
It's nice.
But the other ones are on Saturdays. So I'm like, fuck, man, I'm gonna have to
see. That's a hard
skip
part.
Skip a Saturday
me. Yeah,
here
you know,
or there.
Giving up a day of jiu-jitsu, because my days of jiu-jitsu are limited to Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays for the most part.
Yeah.
And so for me to sacrifice a jiu-jitsu training day, you know, it's a time cost. It's a decision I have to make.
Yeah.
That I don't make lightly. I don't like giving up my Saturday jiu-jitsu days.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I'm with you.
But you get a lot of training during the week.
Yeah.
So it's a little different.
Yeah. I mean, you know, yeah, we train Monday and Tuesday and, coaching kids has its, things that you get out of it. But yeah, I don't know. I've, at least in the short term, I mean, again, I don't want to sound, I don't know what the word is, but in the pursuit of being like a true martialist, it's like, dude, my jiu-jitsu is good enough. Mm-hmm. Like I don't mean that in any, like I'm
not
a fucking
way,
master, not in right. an arrogant way. I just mean like for what I need in a self-defense situation, like odds are, man, I'm not going to be fucking fighting a black belt.
Mm-hmm.
And like we talk about this, like usually the people, like jiu-jitsu scrubs that shit out. Like people that know how to fight usually aren't the ones picking fights because they know what can happen. So like odds are, like who you're going up against has minimal actual training in hand-to-hand combat of any sort. And so it doesn't take a whole lot to, you know, you're saying, man, as a white belt, man, after a few months, someone comes in and doesn't know nothing. All of a sudden it's like, oh, like jiu-jitsu works on some level. Like, I do think you got to get, to be able to truly apply jiu-jitsu in the way that it was meant, where a smaller person can defeat a bigger, stronger opponent through technique. That takes a while to get to that point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would say like people talk about like, oh, you get to like blue belt and you know, you're pretty fucking lethal. And yeah, you are. But to get to the point where size is mattering less, I think it takes more training than that. And so, you know, but you get to a point where it's like, all right, now I'm training to beat other jiu-jitsu guys.
Right.
And that's kind of where I'm at right now. It's like, I'm training to beat other jiu-jitsu guys. I'm not really training to beat someone in the street because that odds are like, that's,
yeah, you know more than 99% of the people out there.
Yeah, and if that's not gonna help, if that's not enough, then the situation may warrant another method of defense. And so, anyways, like I said, like for me, I've already decided, like, man, committing a Saturday a month, at least for a few months, to get out there and do the competition, because man, I feel like you can't help but, I mean, you're. Have your skills increase at a much greater rate.
By putting yourself in that situation.
Yeah. 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 And everything is, there's, when you're first getting into something, man, like, you know, it's like you have to spend a lot of time in order to get better at it. And eventually you get to a point where you don't have to spend as much time to continue to get better at it. And then that's where, you know, you can take time from, you know, like right now I'm going to take a little bit of time from jiu-jitsu and devote to that. Eventually that's going to get to a point where I've got some more time. I don't have to keep doing that. Maybe I really enjoy it and I want to keep doing that. Or maybe I want to fucking get into archery or something, you know? So, I mean, but it's really hard if you're going to have a well-rounded skill. It's just like MMA.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, man.
Where do you focus your time?
Yeah. Yeah. You focus too much on one thing and then you get holes in other areas. And so you just got to figure out what is the most valuable thing for you. But you know, for you, man, jiu-jitsu, like I said, like I do get to do jiu-jitsu. Like for you, it's more than just the doing jiu-jitsu.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's your fucking family, you know, that's your tribe, you know, your way to work off frustration and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, going out and shooting is not a way to work off frustrations.
not when you're new at it.
No,
it can get really frustrating.
Yes. Yeah,
it's another stress.
Yes.
Until you get to a more adequate level, I guess.
Yeah. No, dude, I know, man. It's funny. We went out, took Kelly out shooting, was it Thursday? Fuck, man. Like, I don't know what I'm expecting of myself, but it's not what I do.
I know. There's times, dude. Like, Nate and I went out shooting last weekend before, I think. Dude, and like, there's just times to where I just can't hit the broadside of a fucking barn. Like, what am I looking at?
Yes.
Like, what is happening right now? Like, literally, what is fuck? Like, I sit there and I'll talk to myself. Like, okay, present gone. Sight picture, sight alignment. Where's my window? I mean, it was funny. Like, I actually, this is what I'm saying right now. I actually, at one point in time, was saying this out loud. Okay, on target. front post, sight, you know, back, sight alignment, sight picture. I got equal daylight in the windows. Everything is perfect. You know, squeeze the trigger until I'm surprised by the gun going off. Don't yank it. Like, I had to literally, because I was trying to hit this fucking target, and I just couldn't, dude, like, what is happening right now?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, it's funny.
Yeah, man. No, yeah. It's not, it can be very frustrating.
It's just not second nature yet.
No.
You know, it's, and that eventually, I know it's, like, dude, I've been doing, I love the fact, like, where the level of my jiu-jitsu, I know I'm just an average black belt at best, you know. Yeah. But like, it's second nature now. Like, I've been doing it for so long to where it's just, it's in my DNA.
Yeah.
You know, when it's time to wrestle, it's time to wrestle. Like,
dude, and when things go wrong, you can usually figure out
what's went going wrong.
And right. What do I need to work on to get better? Like,
we're shooting, like, I'm so new, like, I don't even yes. know what's going wrong yes. most of the time. Like,
that's the frustrating part. Yeah. Why is this happening?
Why is this happening?
Why? I got a good sight picture. I'm, you know, I know I'm not doing everything right, but I think I'm doing everything
yeah,
right.
Yeah, for my skill set.
From right my now, perspective.
I'm doing everything right.
Like, I'm obviously not.
I should be hitting wrong? The dead center bullseye every time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's not what happens.
And then I become a, you know, like, fucking dry fire practice, like, I'm a goddamn champion.
And ninja.
Ninja with it.
Yeah.
And I go out and start putting rounds in the gun, and it's like, what is going on here?
I know.
This is insanity.
Insanity.
Yeah. Like, I've had to...
It's funny.
I've got a thing I do now where I'll take a clip, and I'll load it up every other round a dummy round. Mm-hmm. And, like, just, it gets me, like, I found that has helped get me back on track because, you know, even though you know they're there, you're still, like...
And you,
well, you don't want to, like, so, like, you don't want to look like the dumbass who jerks his gun on a dummy round.
Right.
And so, like, I know there's dummy rounds in there, and so that becomes my focus, is don't jerk your gun on the dummy round, and all of a sudden my shooting is better. And, you know, it's like, fuck, man, why can't I... I'm trying to tell myself when I know there's not dummy rounds in there, and it's still, like,
fucking... It's so hard.
Ugh.
It's not... I mean, it's... Dude, it's in our... blood to, like, when something goes bang really loud, you're good, like, you flinch. You have to beat that out of your system.
Yeah.
That's hard to do.
Dude, yeah.
When something goes pop super loud, and yeah, it's so hard not to react. Or especially when you know it's coming. That's the, you know, you're about to cause this big bang. You still flinch. And it's so fucking hard not to do.
It is.
It's years, dude. You just gotta put the time, years.
No, yep, I know. Years. Yeah. But the like I said, though, it's a source of frustration because you don't know what the fuck you're doing wrong. So
yeah, it's funny to relate that to jiu-jitsu, and then we got to wrap this up, so yeah. I got you. But I was wrestling with Ken last night at practice, and beating up on him a little bit because Ken's getting good.
Yeah.
So you can't take it easy on that big gorilla.
No.
Like, you gotta stay pretty sharp because he'll fuck you up.
Yeah.
He knows enough now on his size, like it's. It's a handful.
Oh, yeah.
You gotta pay attention. And, you know, I'd get to side control, you know, I'd just fuck him up for whatever, you know, just keeping pressure on him. And he I asked him, like, you got any questions after, you know, or any areas that are screwing you up? And he's like, no. He's like, man, I gotta figure out, like, what you're doing. He's like, you're pressure and side control. He's like, I don't understand it. You know, he's like, you're so little, you know, you're a little guy, and it fucking really sucks. I was like, dude, I can kind of explain it to you, man, but it's just, you got to put the time in.
Yeah.
It's such a feel. It's so, you can give people the principles, like wait on your toes or don't shift too far this way. This, you can kind of give them some guidelines, but it's a feel thing.
Yeah.
And I got a feeling, you know, when it comes to shooting and not jerking the gun, you know, the anticipation and stuff, I think it's probably the same thing.
Yeah.
Like you just... It's something that's hard to explain.
Oh, yeah.
You can give someone the principles, and you're like, dude, you just got to sort it out.
Right, yeah. No, it is, man. That's totally what it is. Your body's got to learn. Like, yep. That's the... At the end of the day, like, your body just has to have the opportunity to learn how to deal with the situation. And you're trying to keep an idea in mind of, like, this is how I want you to learn, right? So we keep training, trying to do it. But, yeah, there's... You can't replace time on the mats.
No, and I was trying to explain this to Shama last night, one of our training partners, and he's a littler guy, dude. He's like 120 pounds, 130 pounds. And I tried to explain the principle to him. I was like, man, especially being a littler guy than almost all your training partners, like, you have to learn the feel. And what I mean by that, like, when you're on top of somebody, you have these different inputs. And it's not just visual or auditory. Like, there's so much, like, when your upper body is glued to somebody else's upper body, you're getting all these points of contact, and those are giving you input.
Yeah.
You have to learn how to use those. What input are they giving you?
Right.
How are they breathing? Like, if you're close enough to somebody, you can kind of feel their heartbeat sometimes. Like, and when you're new to this, you don't pick up on those intricacies. But as you get time in, I was like, you go by feel. Like, oh, this muscle's tensing, so he's probably going to do this. You know, he's tight here. He's breathing like this. He's probably going to do this. Like, and I bring all that in just from the points of contact I have on somebody's body.
Right.
And, yeah, there's no, you can't make an instructional for somebody on that.
No,
you can,
man.
You can tell them that.
Yeah.
And like, dude, you just got to do it.
You can articulate it after the fact, but right. Like, figuring that out was not a, like a, conscious
no.
thing. Like, oh, this did it for me. It's like, yeah, it's, you're just constantly trying to solve the problem of how do I stop a human being who wants to get up
from getting up.
Mm-hmm. It's a difficult fucking thing, but yeah, no, it's funny you say that, man. I was telling, Adam that trains with us, because he's a lot like I was, whereas like he's really confident with his legs, and so, you know, he sits back too much sometimes. Man, you gotta get up, man. I like, you know, dude, I hear Kevin talking to me mm-hmm. when I was a white belt. But yeah, that's why I was telling him, man, like, it's gonna, you know, right now you just don't feel confident in the top game. It's hard, man, you know, because I totally remember, I know exactly what he feels like, which is that every time I get on top, I just get push back over.
I lose a lot of energy.
Exactly. Lose position. So it's like, well, why not go with what I'm better at? And it's like, you know, I would say like my top game has really only come together in like the last year or two. Like, that's what I was trying to tell him. Like, the jiu-jitsu guy that you see today is not the same guy that I was a couple years ago. Like, my ability to get on top and stay on top and just create like pressure and, you know, like, my mount has been pretty good for a while, but my ability to like really kind of put the top game together, and like, I enjoy it now. Like, I like being on top and smashing people. I couldn't say that a couple years ago. Like, I didn't have the confidence in my ability to do it, and it was just doing it, man. You just got to do it. And there's no, you know, Kevin's told me, you've told me, all these people try to explain, like, here's this thing, but, and for some people it comes faster than others, mm-hmm. but if you know what you're trying to accomplish, you know, keeping a good sight picture or fucking putting pressure on somebody, and you just keep giving your body the opportunity to learn, man, it'll figure it out.
It'll figure it out.
Just gotta have faith.
You gotta give it the right input.
Yeah, there's times when you don't think it will. God, but man, it will.
So frustrating.
You gotta have faith. So
I know. I'll wrap this up. When I was out shooting with Nate, he even stopped and was like watching me shoot one time, and we were shooting at these steel targets that were, they were a little ways away, you know, I don't know, 10 yards mm-hmm. probably. And dude, a shot didn't hit the target, and we seen dust go, like, hit this dirt, like, way over to the left. Like, I'm like, dude, and me and Nate, I was like, dude, there's no way I could have put the round over there. He's like, I don't think you could either. That would have been really bad. I think it kind of ricocheted, like something ricocheted.
Yeah.
You know, and that was a rock or something, like something. Yeah, because, dude, that round went, like, we saw dust go so far away from that fucking target. I hope that was the case.
Yeah, man.
It could have been. I could have just jerked that gun violently. I don't think so. I think it was a ricochet or some rock or something going on, but it was bad. So I know how white belts feel.
Oh yeah, man!
I know how white belts feel.
Yeah, it's frustrating, but cool. Just have faith in the process.
And I didn't talk about coronavirus.
No, man.
Or fucking conspiracy theories or politics or anything. This entire episode,
we made it through.
Make it through.
Fuck yeah!
Cool. So let's call it a wrap.
Let's do it.
See ya.
See ya.
Thank you for listening to the Grumpy Guy BJJ podcast.
Thank you all for listening. You can find us on Podbean, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and wherever else you listen to podcasts. Please make sure to subscribe and leave us a review. It really does help and will allow us to keep putting out episodes. If you have any questions, comments, or ideas, hit us up at grumpyguybjj@gmail.com. Also, go to our website, grumpyguybjj.com, and get signed up for podcast updates
and get our free BJJ Improvement Starter Kit. That's it for now. So get on the mat, train hard, and talk to you all next week. They're calling Daisy Duke, hanging by the lace of their shoes. What? No trace of the tools, shaped in your face. Fuck the rules, snooze you lose. One eye always open, it times two. No clue, but soon a brief monsoon might give you a view to choose. Stay tuned, include, won't conclude. Till the end is near, beware, there's consequences. But what you do.